Professor Jyotirmay Sharma sahab se darkhwast karta hu ki wo lecture pesh kare.
When I was asked what I would like to speak on this day, I thought I would speak on have we misunderstood democracy. The translation that you gave, ki humne kya samajh rakha hai jamhuriyat ko, to Allama Iqbal ka to kafi mashhoor hai ki jamhuriyat ek tarz e hukumat hai jisme bandon ko gina karte hain tola nahi karte. To ab wo tolna hai ya ginna hai wo to aaj pata chalega. But to return back to the theme, have we misunderstood democracy? I think what I will do is to enumerate 6 or 7 points without saying much about them in terms of what my position on it is. But those points that I mention are the points where I think the greatest misunderstanding of democracy in this country lies. And I want to start with a disclaimer. I want to say that I, in no sense of the term, am going by a textbook definition of democracy. You know, we have ideal definitions of democracy, and I'm not necessarily suggesting that we follow those textbook definitions of democracy in any sense of the term. Neither am I suggesting that democracy is the most perfect way of governing people, but it is also the most desirable way, the most perfectly imperfect way of governing people and governing ourselves. And so having put those disclaimers in place, I would like to return to my theme. And the first point that I think has been a great misunderstanding is the idea of freedom. And we have begun in this country to think of the idea of freedom as something which is invariably the idea of freedom for ourselves. Are we free to do this? Are we free to do that? Are we free to say something or do something or achieve something? And I think the idea of freedom is a far more complex idea than simply saying or doing something. It is about ensuring the freedom of others. There is no idea of freedom that will ever become a true idea of freedom until and unless the idea of freedom is about ensuring the freedom of others. It is not about small, restricted group or other identities. Those identities are important, but those identities have to be seen from the perspective of ensuring the freedom of others. Is my freedom coming in the way of others enjoying a certain degree of freedom? I think that's the question, to my mind, which is important. And what is this others? I mean, I think it's important to ask the question, what is this others? Who are these others? It is not about dividing the world into those who agree with me, who do not agree with me. It is not about dividing people into those who are in consonance with me and not in consonance with me. The idea of freedom is about those who disagree with me and ensuring that space for disagreement. I think this whole idea of democracy as my freedom, my ability to do something, to the exclusion of people who dissent, who disagree, who are not necessarily with me, and dividing the world into friends and foes is something which has been vastly misunderstood in this country. To understand the pain of others, I don't want to give contemporary examples because we get into a debate which becomes current affairs. So I'll stick to these broad generalizations. But I will point out where these issues are contentious. These issues are contentious when we talk about the question of protecting minority rights, protecting the privileges and what is due to other sections of society which do not have the natural privileges that some others have had. I'm pointing to Dalits, OBCs, and so on and so forth. There is a reluctance on part of society to ensure their freedoms. And I think there is a great misunderstanding there about the very nature of freedom. The second point, which follows from the first in a certain sense, is that there has to be in democracy an inherent idea of compromise. Democracy is not about a battle where one loses and another person wins. It is not about even a game where one side loses and the other side wins. I think we have incorporated in our everyday speech and in our everyday language too much of two things. The language of the corporate sector at one level. You know, there are corporate battles which are won. People win certain things, achieve certain things, become successful by a battle that is fought in the market or elsewhere. And on the other hand, I think television has done us great harm, because there is every night this unseemly battle that happens on television where five people scream at each other, incomprehensible to either parties. And I think we judge whether one argument has won or not. In democracy, in every sense of the term, not merely in ideal terms, democracy is about compromise. It is not about the victorious and the vanquished. It is about understanding others. It is about reducing inconveniences for others. But most importantly, it is about not humiliating the adversary. By all means, fight against something that you think needs to be fought. Be responsible for what you say, be responsible for your ideas, but not necessarily deal in the business of humiliating the opposite party. Leave the adversary some room to save face. Allow that person to be himself to some extent. I think that is extremely important in a democracy. Which brings me to the next point. Democracy is not about extreme positions. Democracy is not about saying God and truth is on my side, or I have seen the light. None of us have spent enough years sitting under a tree to have seen the light. So that's given to a few people, prophets and great men. I think increasingly the public discourse in this country is about people who seem to think that truth is on their side. There is no scope for discussion. There is no scope for a conversation. People believe that they have seen the light, they have seen truth, and so on and so forth. Which comes from the lack of doubt. Because you can't have compromise, you can't have moderation of any kind until and unless you suffer from any degree of doubt. If you're so sure of yourself that you know everything, that you have found truth, you have found the light, you have found God, you have found everything, then there is no scope for doubt. Then you make strident statements about whatever you think is in your mind, universalize your prejudices, and claim that these are matters that everybody should agree and fall in line. I think that is a danger in our democracy. My genuine advice to people is to stop watching television, actually. Band kar dijiye dekhna. Aadhe se zyada mushkilein is mulk ki apne aap khatam ho jayengi. But the more interesting problem that comes with our misunderstanding of democracy is we take slogans to heart. This country is very famous for slogans. there was a slogan at one point of time which said, India shining. But nobody asked whose India is shining, why is it shining for? Be matlab mein India shining. India shining. And then we have these little cliches about what do we want India to be? We want India to be a superpower. Why? What will India do after becoming a superpower? We want a strong India. We want a nuclear India. We want India to be the next global economy. 9% growth rate honi chahiye. 12% honi chahiye. China se zyada honi chahiye. Nobody stops to ask the question. Once, let us suppose, hypothetically, that we do become all these things. We start shining, we become a superpower, we become a global power, a global economy of great muscle and power. Karenge kya hum? What will we do with it? Will we become better human beings? Will we be kinder to each other? Will the hungry man get his food? Will we be more empathetic towards the poor? Will we treat people who have been deprived on the basis of caste or religion for thousands of years, will their lot be better? What will we achieve? Will we be better people? In other words, what are the principles and values on the basis of which we will be a superpower? I think that discussion today almost has become extinct. Nobody wants to talk about it. Because talking about principles or values that we shall inhabit, when we become whatever we want to become, whatever these sloganeering people tell us we want to become, this will raise very, very uncomfortable questions. Deeply uncomfortable questions about what we are, about our past, about our identity, and so on and so forth. So at the end of the day, I think this is a misunderstanding, that democracy is about the state and the people working towards a single goal of prosperity or achieving strength or whatever else it is. These are very lowly secondary goals. The goal of a country has to be what kind of people will we be? And I think that goal we seem to have lost in terms of asking the question, do we understand democracy better? A commitment to larger principles, larger values. We think of democracy as a money-back guarantee scheme. If refrigerator kharidte hain, to 2 saal ki guarantee milti hai. Ki 2 saal mein kharab ho gaya, to aap wapas lauta dijiye. It's like a money-back guarantee, a service guarantee. Democracy is not about that. Democracy is not about promises being made by people to each other. There are promises, but these promises are also to ourselves. After all, the Constitution starts with the words, we the people of India, and somewhere that we gets lost, we gets obliterated. And I think there is a great misunderstanding there that democracy is about, you know, it's like a deal between or a contract between two people. In the broader sense, it may be a contract, it may be something that people promise to each other. But these promises are not promises that we make in the marketplace or in commercial transactions. These are promises that we make to ourselves. We break those promises sometimes, and sometimes we fulfill these promises. Which brings me to the next point. Democracy is about patience. If someone were to put a gun on my head today and say, what is democracy about? Ki ek labz mein jawab do. I would say it's about patience. It's not about impatience. The middle class impatience. There was a time when I had to tell people I met on a daily basis and also my students. Ek aadat ho gayi thi logon ko kehne ki, ki कुछ भी गलत हो जाए तो कहते थे कि ये तो बिहार जैसा हो गया. If there was lack of law and order, if infrastructure wasn't right, people would say, Hyderabad तो बिहार जैसा हो रहा है. This is the arrogance of the middle class. as if Bihar is not a part of India, as if in the democratic process, I don't owe anything to the people in Bihar. कि हमारी जिम्मेदारी नहीं है बिहार में जो हो रहा है क्योंकि हम हैदराबाद में रह रहे हैं. आई रिमेंबर अ पॉलिटिशियन, अ वेरी सीनियर पॉलिटिशियन सेइंग टू मी इन 2002 व्हेन आई रोट समथिंग वेरी स्ट्रांग अबाउट द रायट्स इन गुजरात, द 2002 रायट्स इन गुजरात, एंड सेड दैट हियर इज दिस मैन, एंड आई कैन नेम नेम्स, चंद्रबाबू नायडू वॉज द चीफ मिनिस्टर एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, एंड आई सेड टू हिम, I said, you hold the key to this government, the government at the center. You have 28 or 29 MPs. You threaten the withdrawal of your support and the government will collapse. And there's a no confidence motion coming. And he said to me, my MLAs are saying to me, why should we bother about Gujarat? You are the chief minister of Andhra Pradesh. You represent the people of Andhra Pradesh. Why should we bother about people in Gujarat? What have we got to do with Gujarat? Leave them alone. I said to him at that point of time, today I'm convinced you'll never be prime minister. So he asked me why. I said, because you don't have an idea of India. There is no idea of India that you have. And I'm not talking about a fixed idea of India. Ideas of India. You see, there must be many ideas of India, plural ideas of India. Part of our problem is that we have had a fixed idea of India, a sort of Sarkari, Doordarshan, AIR, nationalism. One doesn't have to have that. But you must have an idea of India, your own idea of India. But it should go beyond your municipal limits. It cannot be confined to your street or your locality. But democracy there requires enormous amounts of patience. And we have lost that patience because we have fallen into the trap of the middle class, corporatized, what in technical terms is called the technocratic managerial mindset. That everything is about managing. Everything is about solutions which will be given by an expert. Experts cannot give human solutions beyond a point. They can repair a tap or a tube light, but they cannot heal human souls. They cannot do anything to a heart that is full of pain. And that is part of the enterprise of this nation that remains unaccomplished. So I think what we need to do is to move from the individual to a sense of society. Idea of community. And I think it must begin with ourselves. What this whole media explosion has also done is, every cause which is an abstract cause is dear to us. Somebody is fighting for corruption in Delhi, we become very enthusiastic. So I always tell my students, please do not come with a memorandum for me to sign on corruption in Delhi, somebody harassed in Aligarh, somebody harassed in some other place. As long as you can't clean your own campus, question corruption in your own institution, that is the place to begin. And that requires sacrifice. Because people will not, when you are here and now, when you question the institution, you question something wrong that is in your institution, you will face repercussions, direct repercussions. And then you don't need to say, भाई हम तो नहीं कर सकते ये क्योंकि हमको नौकरी प्यारी है, घर में बीवी बच्चे हैं, तो अगर यहां करेंगे नौकरी चली जाएगी तो फिर क्या होगा. यू कांट फाइट ग्रेट कॉजेस एंड ऑल्सो नॉट सैक्रिफाइस योर सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट. आई थिंक दैट्स वेयर अगेन वी हैव मिसअंडरस्टूड द होल आइडिया ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी. द डेमोक्रेसी इज अबाउट एब्स्ट्रैक्शंस. समबडी स्टूडेंट्स कम टू मी एंड से, sir, there is some problem with the ozone layer. Please sign this for carbon emission. Arre bhai, tumhare campus ko clean karo pehle. Ozone layer can wait. But we love abstractions in this country. We love to champion causes that are not here and now. It must start here and now. And that requires an element of sacrifice. There are many tensions, there are many voices in a democracy. And these voices are not always sweet, harmonious. Things in a democracy are not always neat. And this corporate, technocratic, managerial mentality that I've been talking about want everything neat, clean, orderly. A little chaos, a little tension, and they get worried. And I think to understand democracy, one must learn to live and love a little bit of chaos, a little bit of disruption. People come and ask me, oh, so-and-so is agitating about such and such thing. What do you think? Isn't it wrong? Why is it wrong? Let there be more noise. Let there be more chaos. We have come to a stage where we think that little gated communities in Hyderabad are the closest you would get to heaven. I don't think that is heaven. I think we must learn to live. Pandit Nehru had a very, very interesting phrase when he was talking about democracy one day. He said, I don't want a clean, neat, orderly conception of democracy. Democracy is about what he called, and I quote, the noise and chaos of democracy. Until and unless these multiple voices will not be there, democracy will be useless. But today what we have done is, we don't raise our voice against anything. But vicariously, we are spectacle, we indulge in a spectacle on television of people screaming at each other. Vicariously. There are two people at least in this room I know who are guilty of screaming on television. Myself and Professor Kancha Ilaiya, an old friend. We do that regularly. But, you know, doesn't take us very far as a people. To which point I come to the penultimate point that I want to make in this lecture today. And that is, at some given point of time, and this is the great insight that Dr. Ambedkar provided to us. Forms are important. Institutions are important. In a democracy, if you don't cling on to forms and institutions, he called it constitutional morality, it would be very difficult for us to even talk. And that's why he wanted institutions in this country, liberal institutions in this country, secular institutions in this country, to be given the kind of emotional weight that institutions of religion or piety of one sort or the other have had till now. I think that's a great insight. Until and unless you don't give your institutions. Today, all of us love bypassing these institutions. The spectacle that happened in Delhi a few weeks ago was highly dangerous, not merely in terms of the rhetoric. One can live with the rhetoric. I do not mind a set of people agitating. Right or wrong is not our business. They have the democratic space to agitate. But the dangerous bit was the bypassing of institutions. You bypass institutions, I go back to the first point I made. Bypassing institutions sometimes is the recipe for bypassing people like the minorities, like the Dalits, like the OBCs, like the poor, and so on and so forth. It is dangerous. And I think we have misunderstood democracy in the sense that we have ceased to separate individuals from institutions. And I think institutions are important. Institutions are crucial. We must give institutions the respect that they deserve. Emotional respect, formal respect that institutions deserve. One last point, and I'll stop after that. I think democracy is, to recap, about ensuring freedom for others. It's about moderation. Compromise is not a bad word. It should be about compromise. It should be about commitment to larger principles. It should be about learning to live with a lot of chaos, contradictions, paradoxes. But most of all, democracy requires something which I'm delighted to say is also the purpose of this institution where I'm speaking today, and that's language. You lose language, you lose precision of language, you will lose your hold over reality. Today's SMS culture, पीछे लोग बैठे हैं, थोड़ा इस पे ध्यान दें. The shorter your language becomes, the briefer your language becomes, the more cryptic your language becomes, the less is your ability to understand reality, and less is the ability to speak to each other. And until and unless you speak to each other and understand each other, democracy will become an impossibility. I don't want to present a conspiracy theory here, but the scientific establishment today wants our language to be short so that our ability to understand the pain of others. My grandfather and grandmother were doctors, and they used to say, never go to a doctor who doesn't talk to you for at least 20 minutes, because he must learn to understand your pain. You will exaggerate what your pain is about, you will exaggerate your illness, you will suddenly remember things that happened to you which may not happen to you because you are so consumed by your illness. But 10 ya 20 minute jab tak baat na kare doctor, wo doctor nahi hai. Today you are sent straight to a test. Machines deal with you. Because we have lost the ability to listen. The pain, the agony, the humiliation of each other. That happens on a daily basis. And India doesn't shine there. It is nowhere near being a superpower. And if it is at this cost of not understanding each other and the pain of each other, it becomes a superpower, I would not want to be part of that India. I want to be part of a humane, understanding, gentle India, rather than an aggressive, powerful, rich India. So I think that is very important. Language. And I think it is only appropriate that I am giving this talk today at a university which has sworn to preserve a language. So I think it is very appropriate that one is saying here. But my request to you is, learn not merely a language, but also have the patience to tell a full story. Sound bites belong to somebody else. Television again. You know, I call television the graveyard of unfinished sentences. आप बोलना शुरू करते हैं और बीच में कताए कलाम हो जाता है. तो you never finish a sentence. Learn to tell a full story. And when you learn, get the ability to tell a full story, you'll realize that you cannot often compromise with the truth when you're telling a full story. Because you require a narration which is complex, which is complicated, which is nuanced, and so on and so forth. So have we misunderstood democracy? I think we have. I think we have misunderstood democracy in many ways. But in my own small way, I have tried to point out that these misunderstandings can be removed very easily. It doesn't require a very complex process to remove. It can start with you today, here and now. And I think we can reorient, fine-tune our understanding of democracy rather effortlessly. Thank you very much.